Hi guys, my name is Matti Sulanto and in this video I'm gonna shoot one awesome product photo and I also have some product photo tips for you guys if you are into any kind of product photography at home. And some of these tips also apply to portrait photography. So stick around. I'm on this with four other YouTubers, Jimmy Cheng, Peter Forsgaard, Rob Trek, and Robin Wong. Each of those guys are going to publish a product photo video within the next few days. We are on this together because we thought this would be a cool topic in time like this when pretty much everyone is stuck at home. I'll put links to their channels down below just in case you don't know them already. And make sure to check their videos too, because I think we all have some a little bit different approach to this topic, and you're gonna learn a lot from their videos too. I'm gonna first show you what kind of picture I made, and then I'm gonna tell you why I chose this product or subject, and then I'm gonna show you how I made it. And like I said, I have some awesome tips for you guys, and I'm sure they're gonna be useful if you are doing any kind of product or portrait photos at home, if you have a home studio. And the photo I shot is here. It's a jar full of pasta. It's kind of a mixture of a food and product photography, but I chose this because I love cooking and I happen to have this glass jar full of pasta at home. But I have to confess that my original idea was something totally different. I wanted to use light painting and the live composite mode on the G90. And I even practiced with this socket wrench set. I made a couple of test shots. But then I realized that during the day, I can't get this workspace dark enough for light painting. The ambient light is going to ruin the shot. And I had to do the product shoot during the daytime. So I had to figure out something else, and I came up with this jar full of pasta. But I promise you, I'm gonna make another product shoot and use light painting and the live composite mode on the Lumix G90. But I'm gonna have to wait until I have a chance to do the shoot later in the evening so that I can get everything dark enough. My first tip is to pre-visualize before you start making anything in the studio. Because in a studio, you pretty much have a full control over everything, at least in theory. So it's a good idea to pre-visualize. Think about the product you wanna shoot and then think about what kind of a mood, what kind of lighting you want to have in your photo. And in this particular photo I made, I wanted to have a fresh, appetizing look, even though the food is not cooked, but I still wanted to have like a fresh, airy look. And the purpose for this photo is, of course, this video, but I was imagining a client who wants an illustration for a pasta article, maybe on a website or in a magazine. And my client wanted me to shoot a pile of pasta or a jar full of pasta, something like that. And that was my starting point when I started planning this picture. And the lights that I used were LED panels instead of flashes or strobes. And the reason to use LED lights or any kind of continuous light source is that it's so much easier to see what the light is doing. You can see the light and shadow and the lighting ratio also if you use multiple lights. So much easier than with a flash or a strobe. And I highly, highly recommend LED lights also for you if you want to learn how to use lights or if you want to learn how to light in a studio. I have conducted several flash workshops and every time it's the same thing. People are struggling with their flashes, the technical like things with their flashes. They can't figure out how to remotely trigger the flash. They can't figure out the correct output for the flash and all that. And they fail to concentrate on the main thing, which would be learning to use the lights creatively. But with the LED lights or any continuous light, you don't have those problems or those technical things to learn. You just set up the lights and you see immediately what's going on. And the power output is easy. You just use your camera as you would use your camera in any normal ambient light situation. Because I'm a simple guy, I used very simple lighting here. Only two lights. My main light, again, was the Letgo Versatile VM232 LED panel. And the background light is a Yongnuo YN600, I think, an old LED panel that I've had for years. It's not a very high quality panel, but it's okay for something like the background in this case. And the second tip I have for you guys is how to create a good looking white background. It may sound easy and you may just think I'm gonna overexpose the background by about 10 stops to make sure it's white. But unfortunately it's not gonna work quite that easily, because if you kind of overblow the background, it's gonna eat the outline of your main subject, and it's gonna bleed into your subject, also the very overly bright background light. And in the worst case, it's gonna destroy also some of the contrast in your main subject. Whenever you wanna create a white background, make sure it's white but nothing more. So there's no need to overexpose it by several stops. Just make sure it's white but nothing more. And in this case, I started from the background because the Yongnuo panel that I'm using on the background is a lot less powerful than my main light. So I turned the background light on full power and then I adjusted my main light according to that. So my exposure was pretty much determined by the background. So I sort of used my key light as a fill light to get the suitable amount of light on my main subject here. And if this was a paid job for a client, I probably would have used two lights on the background from each side at about 45 degree angle. But since this was only for this video and my workspace is really, really small, I decided to use only one light, and it works pretty well as it is. But like I said, if it was a paid job for a client, I would have been a little bit more careful with my background. But let's take a closer look at my picture one more time. The outline is clearly visible also at the top of the jar, and that's because I didn't overexpose my background by several stops. I just made sure it's white, but nothing more. Here's an example of another picture where I overexposed the background by several stops. And as you can see, the outline of the jar is not visible anymore at the top part of the jar, and there's nothing I can do about it because it's just too bright. It's blown out totally. And the same kind of rule also applies if you want to make portraits and you want to have a white background. Just make sure you don't overblow the background. Make sure it's white, but don't overblow it. The camera I used was the S1R because I just like it in the studio, and the lens is the kit lens 24-105. My focal length was 105mm, f5.6, and 0.4 seconds exposure time at ISO 100. And like I said, my exposure was determined by the background light because it was the least powerful of my lights. I set the background light at full power and then I just adjusted the power output of my key light to match that. And again, if this was a paid job, I might have tried to get rid of the small reflection at the top part of the jar. It's not especially bad or distracting, but I might have played with my lights a bit more if this was a paid job. Or then again, I might have taken two pictures and made a composite in a Photoshop to get rid of the reflection. But in this case, I wanted to keep this as simple as possible, only two lights and pretty much nothing else. I'm pretty happy with this picture. It turned out exactly the way I had pre-visualized it. So make sure you pre-visualize too before you start making any kind of studio shots, whether it's a product or portrait or any kind of studio shot. I really hope this video was useful for you guys, and make sure also to check out Jimmy's, Rob's, Peter's and Robin's product videos that they're gonna put out in the next few days. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and see you in the next one.